So thank you so much for joining us. You are up in Washington right now, Washington State?
I was in Washington until very recently. I am now currently in Florida in the midst of a moving transition, but.
Okay. Is that where you're going to, your new place of employment?
No, I'm still working for the University of Washington for a good while this year.
Okay.
And later on, I'll be transitioning to Woods Hole in Massachusetts.
Oh, okay. Wow. All right. Great.
Are you able to see my slides now?
I will be shortly. Yeah. Yes. Okay. So yes, Martin is, as he mentioned, at the University of Washington Applied Physics Laboratory, and has some amazing insights into the spatial temporal segregation of ocean sunfish species Molidae in the eastern North Pacific, using some great modeling techniques and some large data sets to see some differences going on there. So I'll hand it over to you, Martini.
Thank you. Yeah, it's a real pleasure to be here today to present this work that I did earlier this year with my colleagues at the University of Washington, as well as at the NOAA Pacific Islands Fishery Science Center, looking at these three different mola species in the eastern North Pacific. And I want to start off by talking about how sort of all of this work and being able to do it came as a surprise. The picture that you see in the background is actually of me 15 years ago with the first mola I ever saw in the wild. And it was a huge surprise to have one come up to the boat like that and have this close-up experience with it that was very memorable. And, you know, fast forward 15 years, it was a surprise that I would ever really be doing a project on them. I've always found them interesting, but the data set that I had access to, that is the foundation of this study, I didn't get my hands on because I was thinking I was going to do mola work, but I ended up looking into what was available in it from this massive fishery and realized there was sort of an unprecedented wealth of data, not just on one species, but on three species, all in the same region over a huge spatial area and length of time that could allow us to learn a bunch of new things, especially out in the open ocean, like Dr. Sosa had just said, where we really rarely get to interact with these species. So in particular, I'm going to focus on these three species. On the right, we have the common mola, which is, as you all know, the by far and away the most well-studied species in the family. And on the left, our sharptail and our slender that are comparatively far less studied. And based off of a number of things that people have said early in this talk about phylogeny, morphology, diet, development, and overall size, we know that the sharptail and the common mola are, in terms of their evolution, more closely related to each other than either is to the slender mola. And that's something to keep in mind as we go forward in the talk and compare not only their sort of long-term average distributions, but also the similarity or differences in the spatiotemporal dynamics of their potential migrations. That is, in terms of the pattern and the timing of those movements. So this data set comes from the Hawaiian longline fishery, which, for those of you who aren't familiar, is the largest fishery managed by the U.S. Western Pacific Regional Fisheries Management Council. It's about 150 vessels, largely stationed out of the Hawaiian Islands, that conduct over 1,000 trips per year and cover more than 50 degrees of longitude and more than 45 degrees of latitude. This data set runs over 20 years long, making it sort of just an unprecedented coverage of this area and providing a sampling that would be basically impossible by a regular scientific study that had to go and get the money to try and cover such a large area. So this fishery is divided into two different sectors that operate with slightly different methods and in slightly different regions within the Northeast Pacific. So first we have the deep set sector, which typically fishes between about 100 and 400 meters deep during the daytime in the tropical and subtropical waters extending from the equator up to around the Hawaiian Islands. So in the panel on the top left here, we're looking at the distribution of fishing effort. And these points in the gray represent our deep set sector, again, being primarily around the Hawaiian Islands. In contrast, we have the shallow set sector, which typically fishes at less than 60 meters depth in the nighttime and at the more temperate waters north of Hawaii above 30 degrees north. So in this panel of fishing effort, the shallow set sector is in red, and you can see extends from basically the Central Pacific practically all the way to the US West Coast. So combined, we're looking at over 85,000 longline sets covering this massive area. With this distribution of fishing effort in mind, let's now compare the actual long-term catch distribution of the three mola species to get a sense of what their typical distribution is. So the common mola, which we see on the right here, catches have been extended from nearly the equator all the way up to practically 50 degrees north. But relative to the amount of fishing effort, the species is predominantly caught in these more temperate waters north of 30 degrees and farther east, closer to the US West Coast. That pretty strongly contrasts with the sharptail and the slender mola that are either very rarely or almost never caught in those temperate waters and are largely only seen in that deep set fishery around the Hawaiian Islands and extending farther south to the equator. So already just looking at this massive amount of very basic raw catch data, we have the sense that the common mola is a more temperate species and the sharptail and slender are more tropical, subtropical, which lines up with all of the different infographics that we've seen earlier throughout this symposium comparing their global distributions. But to get a sense of whether they actually overlap or are segregated in both in space and time, we need to more quantitatively look at this data and try to model their migration patterns across the region. So to do this, we built species distribution models for the three species. And in the case of the common mola, we were able to build two, one using the deep set sector data and another one using the shallow set sector data. That way we can compare them, see if the outputs are similar, and if there are any discrepancies, what might be underlying that. So this is how we interpret these panels on this plot and in the following plots. The red colors that you see here indicate higher catch probabilities, and the blue colors you see down here indicate lower catch probabilities. On the x-axis, we have the month of the year, so we start at the beginning. The farther right we go, the later we get in the year. And on the y-axis, we have the latitude starting at the equator and then going up north towards 50 degrees. So what we're seeing are these average sort of north-south movements across the year. And the major pattern that sticks out from looking at these two models here is that they share a pattern of common mola generally moving northward in the spring and then coming back down south later in the summer into the early fall. Now, that largely parallels the season's temperature cycles, as Dr. Sosa had just talked about, which you can see in the bottom right here, where in general, the fish are moving north as the ocean warms up, and then they come back down south as it cools off. But some of you may notice that there's a bit of a discrepancy between these models, which I'm highlighting here in this yellow box on the left. And what this is showing is sort of a secondary area of relatively high catch in the tropics, from about 10 to 20 degrees north, that doesn't particularly match up with where we think common mola should be at that time of year. Well, the extent of our data set only went up through 2018. That happens to be the year when the genus mola was taxonomically redone, part of which including redefining the range of Mola alexandrini, or the bumphead sunfish, to not only be in the southern hemisphere, but to extend also into the northern hemisphere. So they've been there all along, but we didn't necessarily know about that in the past. Having said that, as Dr. Whitney mentioned earlier in his talk, they are relatively unstudied in the Northeast Pacific, so we don't know exactly when or where they do occur, but the little bit of comparative work that has been done looking at Mola alexandrini versus Mola mola suggests that this bumphead sunfish occupies a comparatively warmer niche. So this secondary area of high tropical catch may actually represent misidentified bumphead sunfish that were incorrectly called common mola. Now, that's no fault of the fishery observers. Again, our data only extended through 2018 and the taxonomic redescription happened in that year. So let's now move on to the next species, which you will notice has an entirely different migration pattern as suggested by our modeling. This is the slender mola, and it is clearly not in sync with the season's temperature cycles. It shows an entirely different pattern. So what we're seeing here are really high catch probabilities early in the year around the Hawaiian Islands. The species is then seemingly moving south, disappearing from the region altogether, and then comes raging back north across the equator, where it ends up again around the Hawaiian Islands at the end of the year. We have three different lines of evidence that all point towards this being a spawning migration of adult slender mola. First and foremost, our catch data suggested that these species were exhibiting schooling behavior, which matches up with a number of previous studies. In particular, many individuals at a time were being caught on longline sets, as many as 22 on a single set. On top of that, the size of the fish that the fishery catches is overwhelmingly consistent with that of being adults. Included within that is the new largest size record for a slender mola at almost a meter long. Next up, the area around the Hawaiian Islands is a well-known spawning hotspot for a number of pelagic species like billfishes and dolphinfish and wahoo, and seemingly also the slender mola. And that is attributed to the fact that this region around the Hawaiian Islands persistently has a lot of eddy kinetic energy. Eddies are rotating, coherent oceanographic features that are often generated in the lee of the islands and nearby seamounts that may help to retain and develop the eggs and larvae of these species. Furthermore, when our model suggests that slender mola should have max presence around the Hawaiian Islands is when the region experiences the peak in eddy genesis. So it seems that their migration is in sync with the eddy generation around the Hawaiian Islands so that they can take advantage of those oceanographic features to maximize perhaps their spawning and development success. Lastly, and most importantly, work from over 40 years ago identified the late winter and early spring, again, when our model says slender mola should be there, as being the species spawning season. And they said that because that was when they detected the peak presence of larvae of slender mola in the region. And they wondered over 40 years ago, specifically, you know, are the slender mola just around all the time and it happens to be that they spawn at this time of year? Or are they migrating from somewhere else to Hawaii, spawning, and then going off to wherever it is that they're going? And what our model suggests is that it's very much the latter, that these slender mola are trans-equatorial migrators coming north to Hawaii in the winter and spring to spawn, and then ultimately departing back and going to the South Pacific again. So now we get to our last species and perhaps the most elusive of the bunch, the sharptail mola. And what our model suggested for this species was that it had a much higher presence in the tropics, sort of south of 15 degrees in those warmer waters. And while it has a more southerly tropical distribution like the slender mola, the actual spatiotemporal dynamic of its migration, again, the pattern and timing of its movements, are much more in parallel with the common mola and those seasonal temperature changes. Again, matching up to what we know about their evolutionary relationships. So we see this species seemingly moving north again in the spring and early summer as it warms up, and then they're coming back down south later in the year as it cools off. Now, this migration, as Dr. Sousa had mentioned before, this kind of migration may be directly related to temperature as well as indirect effects on regional productivity, but there's also some evidence that suggests that this may, at least in part, also be a spawning migration. Research cruises from around Hawaii in the late 1940s identified really high numbers of the early life stages of this species around the Hawaiian Islands at about the exact time our model says these adults should be there potentially to spawn. Furthermore, as Dr. Friese's work highlighted earlier in the Northwest Atlantic, which happened at pretty much the exact same latitudes, their evidence suggested that the sharptail and the slender mola exhibit segregation and spawning activity. And our work backs that up very strongly because our models, as well as all those previous studies on the early life stages of these two species, identify the slender mola as being around Hawaii in the late winter and early spring, and the sharptail mola as being there in the late summer, perhaps early fall. So very strongly suggestive of temporal segregation in the spawning activity, not only in the Pacific, but also in the Atlantic. Now, I've used this fishery data set to actually, you know, try and learn about the individual species and compare them to each other in their movement ecology and their reproductive ecology. But I think it's important that we also use this data to talk about how fishery dynamics can affect the conservation of these species. In particular, I want to focus on the common mola in the shallow set sector of the longline fishery. Again, that's that more temperately distributed fishery north of 30 degrees, extending from the Central Pacific all the way to the US West Coast. And what we're looking at here is a figure of the probability of a longline catching a common mola over the 24 years of our study period. And what should stand out to you is that in these 5 years prior to this fishery closure, the average probability of capture was more than 4 times higher than it was in the 14 years after. So to understand why that might be the case, I need to tell you a little bit about the fishery closure. The fishery was closed from 2001 to 2004 due to interactions with endangered sea turtles. And when the managers went to reopen the fishery, they said, you know, we have to come up with a way to reduce the likelihood of these interactions occurring. And what they came up with were changes to the type of gear that fishers were allowed to use. So what they did was they banned the use of squid as bait, and they banned the use of J-hooks, and instead mandated the use of whole fish as bait and the use of circle hooks. That combined regulatory change reduced sea turtle interaction rates by 90%, which is a massive drop. And it seems that that regulation change not only benefited the turtles, but also benefited the common mola, because it seemingly caused this huge drop in the probability of capture. Now, some of you might notice that since 2005, in these 14 years after, there has been a slow but steady increase in the probability of capture again. And our leading hypothesis for why it has started to creep back up is because over this time period, the fishery, this sector of it, has progressively shifted farther and farther east, ever closer to the California current large marine ecosystem, which, as much of Dr. Tice's work shows, that is a well-documented common mola hotspot. And unfortunately, it's also home to a large mesh drift gillnet fishery, which catches more than 2,500 molas per year and has a catch rate of molas that is either more than 1 or 2 orders of magnitude higher than what is seen in the 2 different sectors of Hawaii's longline fishery. But when you add up those high drift gillnet fishery catches with the comparatively minor catches of the longline fishery from Hawaii, you put it all together, and it is of potential conservation concern, because as we know, this species is listed as both vulnerable and decreasing by the International Union for the Conservation of Nature. With that, I'd like to conclude by thanking all of my collaborators and colleagues who helped to make this work happen, as well as the organizations that funded myself and them in doing this project. And I'd like to stress that I think that there is a lot more work that can be done looking at this kind of fishery-dependent data. There have been a number of studies before my own here, but there is a lot of untapped data around the world that I think we could learn a lot more about these species, especially out in the open ocean where, as I mentioned before, it's really just not typically logistically feasible to conduct any sort of very large-scale study on those species. So I would encourage those of you who know about such data to see if you can look into it and what might be worth learning from that, both on species individually, but also in comparison in sympatry, as I've done here.
Wow. Oh, Martini, that's fabulous. Absolutely fabulous work. I mean, just terrific. And so interesting to use these different data sets from different areas and see, you know, what's supporting the literature from the past, and what these models are supporting in different ocean basins. And so it's really looking like, I mean, it's detective work that each clue is reinforcing the next one.
I think that was one of the things that surprised me so much about this was, you know, I can try to build as valid and carefully constructed a model as I can. But at the end of the day, you know, it's math playing with the catch data that we have, and to see that it lined up right, as well as it did with so many different fields of inquiry about these fishes was kind of mind blowing to me. It was almost too good.
No,
Kerry, I'm going to say, man, I don't know if you run many classes, but if you do, send me the link, because that was flipping unreal. That I'm buzzed up about that. As a 50-year-old man, that's about as much energy as I've managed to cram into the last year. That was so good. I think your ideas are good. I really like it. there's something I'm playing around with, because it's funny, because I come from a leatherback background, then I moved into sunfish. The commonalities are all over there. And it's the term migration is really weird, because when we talk about migration, we have this thing in our head of this reciprocal, you know, you start here, you go there, you start here. With the basking sharks that we're working on at the minute, we're kind of stealing more terms from primatologists, like fission fusion, you know, like busting out into the ocean and then concentrating back in for spawning. Because I wondered if you had any thoughts about that, you know, in terms of when you say they're moving south. Fascinating, and I buy the evidence that they're in groups. Totally buy that. Going somewhere, or do you think they're roaming when they move south?
You know, that's the benefit. I guess that's the benefit of telemetry, is you're tracking the animal, so you know what that one is doing, versus I'm sort of looking at the average integrated signature of fish through time over space. So as a, you know, the average distribution is shifting, but are they all, you know, in unison shifting south perfectly? Certainly not. There's got to be plenty of randomness to that. And what I'm able to detect with fishery data like this is just that average signature.
You are, but you also maybe even more, because if you're picking up clusters of animals moving together, it's cool. And telemetry is not as all powerful as you think, because it's until we've got sat tags running for 10 years, we're not. You know, we have that whole, an animal's gone somewhere, we're like, hey, why did it go there? And it's going, it didn't go there, it was just going past there. That's where the tag stopped. I think that's brilliant. And there's so much more to the pelagic, because a lot of our knowledge about sunfish is coastal.
That's what I was going to say, that there's a lot going on. And this idea that they're, you know, keying in on the eddies, you know, eddy genesis and circling in there, especially for spawning sites. It just makes sense.
Yeah.
You know, and that bycatch date for leatherbacks was phenomenal. You know, a lot of the work out of, you know, Hawaii and everything for looking at that Pacific and loggerhead connectivity. I didn't know it reduced. I knew it reduced the circle sea hook thing. Mm-hmm. I didn't know it reduced sunfish bycatch.
Well, nobody had looked at it.
Yeah.
So nobody knew until we did this. You know, there's a lot of older papers that look at catch rates before and after that change. Mm-hmm. And there's a number of species that seem to have responded, with many on average looking like they went down, but others looking like they actually went up. It's sort of a mixed bag. Nobody had quantified the ocean sunfish, because while it is recorded by observers of the fishery, it is certainly not one of the species for which management is mandated in the region. They look at the billfish and the tunas and the sharks, and then any endangered species like the turtles and the marine mammals. But the observer data set is filled with weird fish like this that is not, you know, people don't necessarily have the time to take a look at.
Right. What other kind of fishes are in there?
A lot of weird mesopelagics and odd epipelagics, you know, pelagic puffers, pelagic stingrays, lancet fish, snake mackerel.
Lots of
strange things.
Oh, that's interesting, because lancet fish and snake mackerel have been recorded as eating mola larvae. So there's lots to plumb there. Lots to mine. Yeah. Really, really interesting work and terrific. So what's next for you, Martini? Are you going to keep delving in here? Are you off to other things? Or are you going to keep?
Well, I'm more than I'm like an all around equal opportunity studier of fish. So if it swims, I'll study it. That's easy enough. You know, you throw a good mola idea at me and I'm happy to do it. I'm actually in conversations with Dr. Nygaard about helping her with some work that she's been doing, because I also do telemetry work on a number of other species, but have not done molas before. So that'll be interesting to apply some of those techniques to that as well. But my main work right now is looking actually about the eddies in the North Pacific subtropical gyre and how they structure pelagic predator behavior.
You've got my dream job. That's the one thing I'm fascinated, because me and Tom years ago, Tom Doyle, he put up a really lovely GIF, which is just on altimetry data, looking at kind of mesoscale eddies, etc. and you see leatherbacks moving down and then just hooking up in an eddy.
Yeah.
And just flipping. And you got, first of all, like, why is it swimming around in circles? And you're going, it isn't. It isn't. Yeah. You know, it's so cool. Oh my God. That's, oh,
that's, I'd be happy to chat more with you about eddies. I can talk to eddies for no end.
Yeah, yeah. I'm from a physical oceanography background originally. I'm rubbish at it now, but yeah, I'd love to. Let's do that. Let's do that.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Great, great. Cool. All right. Well, Martin, are you available for questions, if people have questions from the audience?
Absolutely. Yeah.
Okay. So we will put that into the YouTube. We'll put up your email and have that available for people. And hope you can stay tuned for what's to come.
Yeah. Thanks for having me.
As I will do a shout out, Mayana Nygaard, who wrote our fisheries chapter, has been plumbing the depths, plumbing the data on fisheries throughout the world. So I think you'll be really interested in that presentation as well.
Yeah, absolutely.
And that chapter. Okay, well, stay tuned and then come back for happy hour.
Thanks.